Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our afternoon PQ Talks. We are continuing with our theme of collaboration. We have a wonderful, very special collaborative project, a presentation of it, on it ahead of us. Let me introduce our speakers. I'm going to start with Markéta Fantová, who is based in Prague, performance designer, and also our wonderful PQ artistic director. Next to her is Chase D. Anger, who is a choreographer, performer from the United States. And then Evelyne Leblanc-Roberge, I tried my French, didn't work. And she's coming from Quebec, and she's a multimedia artist, right? So please join me in welcoming them. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara, for inviting us to share our 12-year collaboration, Letter to the World, and our thoughts about collaboration with you. So we're going to begin by first, we'll describe the work a little bit, and we will show you some photos and some brief clips. Then we will talk about collaboration, what we learned and what we're continuing to learn. We'll then ask you if you wish to participate in Letter to the World 6, right here, and then we will answer questions. Letter to the World series includes 5 works collaboratively created by us, Chase, Markéta, and Evelyn. So that's Letter to the World 1, that's Letter to the World 2, that's Letter to the World 3. That was done at World Stage Design in Wales. That's Letter to the World 4. Letter to the World 5's coming. There it is. It's coming. And then we did one satellite project, and then which was called Savings, which was in an abandoned bank. And then the next picture is just of us. So Letter to the World was initially inspired at PQ 2011. Anybody go to PQ 2011? Yes! Nice. So it was the PQ architecture talks, and I was looking through the catalogs, I had been to the exhibits, and I was like, oh, this architect talk looks interesting. And it was given by architect anthropologist Franco Lucia, and he was discussing the social impact of architecture and city planning. So I randomly went to this talk thinking it would be interesting, and in the middle of the talk, I start ugly crying. And I am not talking like, ooh, I had a little tear. I mean, I was sobbing. It was quite embarrassing. But what was happening was that he was speaking about the power of public space by then describing the Arab Spring that was happening that summer in Cairo, Egypt, where over 100 million people gathered in the square. And this square, the center of the rebellion that led to radical change that summer, was a space that could hold that amount of people, and the energy and the information and everything could be shared physically in that same time and space, but also through the images that the world was seeing at that time. He then shifted the conversation to talk about how those spaces were being diminished and instead were being replaced with an architectural trend called ubiquitous architecture, a style that emphasizes virtual connections between people and others via technology like FaceTime in individual apartments, all stacked up one on top of the other. So we have to remember that this is 2011, this is pre-COVID, and when he spoke about going into an apartment where the walls were like screens and how you could virtually talk to anybody, anywhere, at any time, but really, you were physically alone in your apartment, was radical to me and like ridiculously upsetting. So now, 2023 to you today, that would not be shocking at all. I'm not saying you would like it, but it would not be shocking. So my 2011 messy reaction was intense, physical, and a little embarrassing. But I couldn't understand how and why we would move towards this type of architecture and away from creating town squares, promenades, parks, public spaces where people could connect socially, spontaneously, and physically, and places where rebellions and protests and information could be exchanged, or a place where you could meet your possible next partner or lover. I just wanted to say lover in this talk. That felt good. I hope that felt good to you. I hope you're all awake now. So when I spoke to Markéta and Evelyn, and I was like telling them about my meltdown, we started to talk about this topic, and then we realized that we all deeply shared the same concerns passionately. So 9 years before COVID, we began creating Letter to the World 1, which later led to a series, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. With each piece, each subsequent piece, we would remove more of the live element in the work. So Letter to the World 1 was all live in a theater, and by the time we got to Letter to the World 5, not only wasn't there a live event, but there was no movement at all, like nothing on video or anything like that.
Yeah, so just to quickly go over Letters to the One, what it was about. A Letter to the One was a piece in the Miller Theater, a newly finished, wonderful proscenium theater. And it was made of duets or individual dancers. It was 9 of them. And they were enclosed in boxes with the edge made out of white tape. They stayed contained within that area. And each box or each area was lit incredibly precisely, which it seems simple, it was really, really hard. So the light, there's absolutely no light spill beyond that line or beyond, like, sticking a hand out, you would be out of the light at that point. Those dancers danced in each square. They danced to a different type of music, and there is a different type of a story in each one of them. They were dancing on Dina Washington, Is She or Is She Not My Baby, or to salsa, or to Baroque music at the end, to a minimal duet. This work took advantage of capabilities of the theater, the fact that it was a proscenium theater, its depth, its equipment, and in a way, being in a theater, and I have to say this as a performance designer, is very comfortable space to be because there are rules and it's clear what needs to be done. In fact, working on this, I go to technical rehearsal to relax, which is wrong, but that's what happened this past year. Immediately after the performance, we created 5 videos. Those videos were shot in an abandoned post office, which was a historical and had a meaning to the community of the town where we did that. I'm just waiting for the slide of the... it's there. So you can see that it was abandoned for a while.
The next one.
But also the walls provided very interesting textures, really beautiful background for the film. Each room had quite vivid colors of the stuccos on the walls. And then we used the films that were shot there on that location of the post office for another piece, Letter to the World 2, that was located on all 3 floors of Elks Lodge. I don't know if you know what Elks Lodge is, but it's not exactly the same or not completely similar, but similar maybe remotely to a Masonic lodge for those who have no relation to what Elks Lodge is. And there we included live performances together with the film that we shot and in combination. The audience that was coming in, there were several locations throughout the building from the first to the third floor. We used locations very specifically connected with what was happening in them. And the audience was limited to 15 people only at a time. And they were led on guided tour through this immersive installation. The experience lasted about 20 minutes. and included an integration of video installations and live performance. We considered really every single location very carefully, as well as how the audience, the dramaturgy of the audience in their locations. Evelyne? I'll just maybe add that this was a view from a window, so the audience was up above on a third floor looking down.
Thank you. So, Letter to the World 3, which was performed at World Stage Design in Cardiff, Wales in 2013. It took place in three areas, a bus station, a park, and a crowded cafe. The performers this time integrated into the local scenes, and audiences happened upon them, discovered the piece by themselves without guidance. The viewers were not directly guided into the work like our previous piece. How they approached the work was up to them. The white costumes and choreographed minimal movement was an indicator that they were not regular pedestrians, but they were more approachable than in the previous experience, Letter to the World 2. The majority of the dances were performed on screens that took place inside the boxes. These videos were iterations, and they were reframed both by small boxes held by the performers and also by the larger location where the performances where the experience happened. For a Letter to the World 4, we then removed the live performers altogether and installed the boxes that we used for Letter to the World 3 on the floor in empty rooms in a former church in Rochester, New York, for a site-specific art event titled Compartmented. Audience members laid on the floor or crouched down to see the filmed performance in the boxes. Because of the scale of the boxes, the experience was intimate, a bit awkward, and the viewers became performers in a way. For Letter to the World 5, we imagine a newspaper print publication with images of previous iterations. No performers, no video, no movement, no music, no text. The object was sent to the viewer to be opened alone in their house. The newspaper format assembles many of the elements we worked with in the previous manifestation of the project. Paper, container, time-based and intimate viewing, archive, and memory.
So that's the end of that section. So that's the description. Now you sort of have a sense of Letter to the World 1 through 5. So we created these questions for this talk to be able to think about these things and write our own individual responses to talking about ego when it comes to collaboration, to talking about how do we know when we're compromising in that, is that good for the work, or are we just compromising for the sake of agreement? What are some strategies for dealing with conflict when collaborating? And how does knowing yourself, like knowing what your strengths and weaknesses are, you can't be perfect or good at everything, play into choosing your collaborators to work with you? And has our gender identity and cultural background affected our collaboration? So now I've got a... Yep. So at the very beginning of this process, from the very, very beginning, we decided probably the most fundamental part of our collaboration, which was we decided to write co-created by. So instead of working in defined roles as a choreographer, a sonographer, and a multimedia artist, we gave that up and exercised our creativity beyond our specific training, sort of spilling beyond our own boundaries. And it was freeing. We explored creating in each other's sort of genres, but we also deferred to each other's specialties when needed, and with some of the pieces, some of us would step up to lead at different time. But that leadership would be temporary, it would be fluid. You would step up because that's what the piece needed, not because you were defined to be the leader. It was about serving the creation of the work, which and not ourselves, which was relieving. We followed this up and reinforced it by writing co-created by on our press, on our proposals, and on our PR. So working this way for over 12 years together, we continued to develop our interdisciplinary skills, not being bound by our identities, but having the freedom to explore and the freedom and time to practice interdisciplinarity. So Markéta and Evelyn, they made choreographic decisions, but they're not suddenly writing on their business card, choreographer. You know, I made decisions about our video composition, but I'm not suddenly like a videographer. So we don't necessarily worry about those identities and take those into it, but we just have the freedom to be able to explore and practice. And by removing the issue of authorship and roles and focusing solely on the work, we were able to move fluidly within our collaboration, practice these interdisciplinary skills, and develop trust. This piece not only developed over time, but it developed across space. So during the 12 years, we changed as artists and as people, sometimes together and sometimes in three different countries. Our shared and our separate experiences over time in different places forged us and forged the artwork. Speaking for myself, when I went to the architecture lecture in 2011, I was a messy, teary pile of wild despair. And what's sad is that so much of what I feared has come to fruition, and even worse than what I imagined. Not to be a downer. And a lot of this happened because of COVID, but not exclusively from COVID. So when COVID hit, yes, we were all alone in our homes, talking over Zoom, isolated and not physically connected, just like what Dr. Lechecki described in his lecture. My dance classes during COVID were literally taught in white boxes defined by tape, 10 feet away from each other, and we had masks. So it's that, not that, but the picture of Letter to the World One is what my dance studio looked like. And I would have never imagined that. So to go from wild fear of the future to infusing the same project along the way with actual lived experience of the longer present has been intense. And also, speaking about like the power of public spaces within the US, because I'm just speaking for myself, the death of George Floyd, the attack on women's rights, the attack on LGBTQ rights, like we need public spaces now more than ever to publicly protest and try to create change. And of course, Evelyn and Markéta and I are not experiencing the times and events exactly the same. We are not one mind. Our lives and the surrounding circumstances are different. Markéta left New York and she came to the Czech Republic and is now the top dog of PQ. Evelyn is going to international residencies around the world, writing the most beautiful books on the planet. You'll have to buy her book, you know. And I have had like wild changes in my work and my home life. We'll talk about it over beer. But we have been changing and growing and developing through good and difficult experiences. So with both the individual and the societal shifts, changes, our need for connecting to each other in real time and space has only increased. I want to spend my time with artists like Evelyn and Markéta, making art that connects us to what matters, to each other, and to the larger community through the art that we create. Switching topics in regards to ego, I think that's gotten easier over time. In the very beginning, we were all working together in the same academic institution. So being artists in academia is tricky. I hear Maureen, yes, it's tricky. understatement, because academia creates an atmosphere of scarcity and hierarchy. It demands that you are at the top of your game with your name attached, your personal branding demanding or demonstrating that you are knowledgeable, and that knowledge is attached to your name. Yet being an artist and a collaborator asks you to be vulnerable, to be sensitive, and to relish and be courageous in the unknown, to swim in ambiguity. So choosing to work in a collective working model over succumbing to academic pressures supported our art and supported us as artists. And we would like to offer that to support you as well. So we are actually living what we were simultaneously creating a work about.
And just going back now to reflect on what Chase said, because she said we are not the same person. So each one of us had really different view on these things. So when we started this project and Chase came from the architecture talk in Prague, well, yes, as she says, I do come from the dark part of the world, this part of Europe, so I have dark thoughts all the time. So, you know, I thought that things might not be so peachy in the future already. But her coming from the talk, actually, when she told me what she went through and that she was so moved, for me, the feeling was positive because I thought, this is wonderful. She got inspired by this event. And now it's even greater meaning for me because that means this event inspires people to do projects that then go on and go on maybe in series for a long time, which is wonderful. But I felt that the loneliness, the seclusion, the complexity of close relationships and the loss of meaningful dialogues, that was something that we really, really connected on. And that my optimism was about, we have something to share, and even though maybe the roots of that thought is dark, what we're sharing can lead to something that is a collaboration that brings light into it. When we started talking about the white squares, the dividers, the lines, all of these things, how the spaces are actually defined, immediately at that moment, I started to have images in my head, because once you start giving me shapes and things like that as a designer, immediately my mind just goes into a different world and start thinking about all kinds of things that might relate to what Chase sensed from that architecture talk. So I started to see division between rich, poor, happy, sad, streets divided only from, you know, poor side, one by street, and then a rich neighborhood. And in my head, I had these images. When I fly, I look at the landscape, and the landscape and the urbanism oftentimes speaks about our inner selves as well. It's sort of a reflection of our minds, and where we live reflects back on our minds again. So the US landscape being the squares, that's where I went with my mind, not of the seclusion, but actually a different landscape over there versus European landscape, which is organically grown. So those were my thoughts in the beginning. Prior to Letter to the World, Chase and I already collaborated, and as she said, it was also an academic, tricky environment. And Chase is, she has the fierce ability to bring people together. She is a choreographer, she's a mover, she has this super high energy. I don't have that. I sometimes live in the back of my head, and honestly, right now, I don't have much energy left. And then Evelyne is a wonderful visual artist who likes to work alone in a studio, and she loves being alone, developing these ideas and think about them. Well, I'm not capable of that either. I go to the studio, and I would die if I were to stay alone all the time. So I felt like I'm somewhere in the middle, sort of bridging those two things. I stay in the studio when I'm working on a show. I love that thinking process. But once I've finished, I need to get the hell out into the space and start doing things. And then the energy comes. So at the same time, watching these two different processes, I have learned enormous amount of ideas and stuff and ways of getting to opening some problems from these two women. So that was really wonderful. And in the beginning, what was very nice by stripping that whole idea of this is the choreography, this is this, and having these silos that we have in scenography as well, it felt incredibly freeing to me, because all of a sudden, I wasn't compartmentalized in something that has some borders. I wasn't actually put into that wide box with a defined line, and I could think, and I knew that I can trust them, that if I go somewhere where it's really not working for the piece, they will definitely stop me. So it's like wearing VR and somebody tells you when you're running into a pole. I don't know if yours is here, because I did run into a pole the other day. So this whole ego label driven category world, as Chase mentioned, we managed to shatter that. That was an incredible feeling, and I still believe that that process, that possibility is really important in the arts. Some of that rubbing into what we're doing here with PQ. Our team is not hierarchical, although so it inspired back, by the way, this structure of some of these things here. And also, just to say about some of these academic environments that we talked about, those are tricky, but so is the professional world. When you're working on a show, you are in a highly hierarchical environment, especially here in Czech Republic, where sometimes still the director is on top of the pyramid. And it gets really tricky because you don't know where you can step and where you can't. Being vulnerable becomes guarded. When you're with people, you realize where you can be and where you cannot be vulnerable. And when you can allow yourself to be completely vulnerable and cry and be that ball of mess, you're with the right people, you're in the right place. What I also realized, and this is the last thing I'll say on this piece, everybody in sonography performance design in the beginning dreams of, oh my God, I want to work for that giant theater, do this really big show, and it will be lots of material, everybody will see it, and we'll have a full house, I want to work on Broadway or whatever. Well, actually, learning about the community we worked for, learning about the people we're doing the work for, and seeing them cry in that small Elks Lodge has explained a lot to me. Ever since that moment, I realized that it doesn't matter. The bigger the house, the further away you get. The fancier the scenography, the further away you get from the heart of what it needs to be. So that piece really taught me something very important. It is not about bigness, it's about the heart. And if that doesn't come out, what are you doing it for? So that was a huge learning moment for me in that Elks Lodge when that happened.
So me coming from my lonely studio, my contribution to the project started after an invitation from Chase, whom I knew just a little bit from a previous short collaboration, from which the roles were, I was to create a video piece documenting a site-specific performance around a lake in Alfred, New York. And the role were quite defined from the start, even if we all have multidisciplinary practices, we more or less kept to our own craft for that piece and our own unknown respective creative language. What Chase didn't know at that time, or maybe not fully, is that this first video piece I created for with her was an entirely new process for me. I was coming from, as I said, a lonely world of still photography and installation practice, and I was still very much intimidated by video as a medium. Movements, both my camera moving and things and people moving in front of my camera, as well as sound and the almost infinite possibilities of editing something on a timeline, were elements that were so new and scary to me. I had a huge case of imposter syndrome. But we found common creative languages and things that we were both fond of. Frames, the act of framing, the in-betweenness of a frame, stillness, slowness, crisp images, paper, spaces, our relationships to spaces and architecture and landscape. The very loose and open parameters of the collaboration for the project Letter to the World were seducing to me. We all had common interests, but at the same time, we're coming from different practices, fields, countries, cultures. Then I got to meet and know Markéta and her craft as a scenographer, a fascinating world that was totally new to me as well. But yeah, I was hesitant to jump in at first. Always scary to jump out of your comfort zone. And also I did just graduated with my MFA and was just lost and anxious and for what would happen next in my practice as an artist and as a person. And I had never collaborated this way, co-creating a piece. As I said a few times now, my practice thus far was one of a loner in the studio, working with computers and cameras and prints, and carefully planning every little element of an installation or pages of a book without having to negotiate with other humans, only with the limits of the materials or spaces I was working with. Or if I was working with people, it was in the shoes of a photographer directing models, more for a hierarchical kind of system. But I'm so glad I did jump in and said yes to Chase's invitation as this project unfolded in many meaningful conversations, travels, and life and learning experiences. And it's still going on here. 12 years later. The shared responsibilities of a co-created piece is freeing, as Chase and Markéta mentioned, and also brings lightness to both the making process and the piece itself. What I love the most about the Letter to the World project and our collaboration, its space and the serial aspect. It's a slow project. I like that each fragment is a carefully designed piece on its own, but also part of a longer, slower exploration that we're doing together. I love how we develop the work as we go and as we get a new opportunity to install, share the piece, as we visit new spaces and share our reactions to these spaces. I also love that we can pick up the work after a long time has passed and then get back to it. I love the respect and trust that we have for each other as persons, as makers. I love that we all are all detail-oriented, not perfectionist, apparently not. That's a new word, detail-oriented, but not necessarily oriented on the same details. That these details, and that these details then get cross-pollinated. I also love that we all laugh a lot together and that we don't take ourselves too seriously. We share that. That's just make the work more pleasant and fun. Through this experience, I learned and I'm still learning about myself as a maker, about communicating, about speaking up, about being comfortable in group settings. That's a skill I'm still learning and working on, about observing and listening, about teaching and sharing knowledge. I also learned a lot about doubt and how it is a powerful creative fuel. This is the end of the third section of the second section. Then we're going to move on to the third section. Let me get back to the script. So we will dedicate that part to two things. First, another experiment in collaborating. And also, I'd be super happy to take any question you may have for us. So we want to invite you to write your own letter to the world today in this room, to co-create a piece together with us at this very moment. So we have paper, pencils, and a mailbox here, and you can interpret this prompt as loosely as you wish, starting, for example, by defining the word world as it fits for you today. You can use words, but and also in any languages that you feel comfortable, you can mix and match. You can also use images, marks, traces. And you can keep that letter for yourself, or you can share with us in the mailbox once you're done. We're going to kind of slowly collect them. There's more, yeah. And I guess we can take, leave them questions. We can answer questions at the same time that you're reflecting, that you're creating your own letter. The question can be addressed to all of us or one.
One of us?
Yes.
Yes, Maureen.
Would you speak about a moment in the collaboration where you were sort of at an impasse and how you resolved it?
Did you say impact, conflict?
Impasse.
Like impasse.
When it got sticky.
Okay. Who stars?
Well, you know, you get tired.
And you cranky.
So Markéta and I think Markéta and I tend to sometimes be a little fiery at times. And, but I think a lot of this actually happened a little prior to this. So I think because of the pressure of academia, actually, like I like to blame it on that. Where, and I think actually it was through some of those disagreements that we had in academia that got us sort of upset, and that's where the disagreements would come. So that's part of the reason why we said co-created. So once we said co-created, we just relaxed, and we just were able to work in a way that it's not gonna have her name on it, or it's not gonna have my name on it, it's gonna have all of our name on it. So I think that's how we dealt with it. Not to say that once we said co-created by, it was perfect, because it wasn't. There were times when, again, but I think also because we did it over time, our communication skills got better. And we were better able, so I can read Markéta in a way a year later, 2 years later, 3 years later, in a different way, and was able to read her in a way that I could step back or step forward. What I also learned was that my legs are really good for conflict, in the sense that once I'd learned to just walk away sometimes, like, oh, like, Evelyn's having a day, you know, maybe I just need to, like, take a few steps back and not engage with that, like, that ability to leave, which is a little easier with site-specific work, too. You're in a park. You're like, I think I'm just going to go over by this tree, let this one simmer down. And not to say that she was perfect, because she wasn't. She was brilliant. But I think that was it. It was a relationship dealt over time and sort of breaking away from academia and breaking away from those roles.
But I would also add to that, I think one of the most important bits of that is to want to invest in that relationship, the honesty. And that's the moment where you feel you can either walk away from it all or you can fight. But if you don't have that investment where you feel like, I will be honest whatever is the result of that, and say, I don't want, because I remember one, I can say a specific example. And I think it does come out of not necessarily just academia, but it comes with also feeling responsible for a certain delineated area that comes, like you're learning in school. This is what you're responsible for as a scenic designer, as a lighting designer, as blah, blah, blah. And there are procedures how you follow those things. All of a sudden, there come projects that don't fit within these borderlines. And then you cannot, with your collaborator upfront, say, This is where it ends. It doesn't work. World doesn't work that way. So you're going to run into a conflict sooner or later. The question is, when you get into the conflict, are you strong enough to say, this hurts, I am not going to go there with you? And sometimes even say, like, this is not a project I can do in this capacity. I will do it in a different capacity, or I won't do it at all. And I think that's really, really hard. And I remember this was prior to this project, but we had these conversations. And we did cry time to time, because it's painful to go through these steps, but once you get through them with some collaborators, you kind of clear the air, and then anything goes after that. It's like, oh yeah, we can say whatever we want to each other because we know we're safe. Yeah, and we're not trying to hurt each other.
I think we're like really good at asking questions instead of saying affirmation. Like we ask to verify, like, is mm-hmm. this really what you, like, we're asking a lot of questions to each other. I think I've learned that anyway. Mm-hmm. And listen to the answer to the question too. And it's not just about asking the question, but.
Yep. I also think I learned how to fight with Markéta because in the beginning, you know, I'm not a fighter. I don't like conflict. But I knew after a while the trust developed. And when the trust developed and we would get into a fight, it was about the artwork. So it wasn't about the ego. Hi, Laurel. It wasn't about the ego. It wasn't about the, you know, whatever. It was about the artwork. And so then when we would fight over the artwork, it allowed us to create that better thing, to see the artwork in a different way and to see what are you willing to keep fighting for or what do you need to just step back on because it's actually a better idea. And I actually am really appreciative of that situation to be able to. And also what Markéta was referring to earlier, before we worked on Letter to this project, we collaborated on other projects, but we also said no to other projects. So there's some projects where Markéta was the lead. There were some projects where I was the lead. There were some projects where we were co-leads. But we made that agreement in the beginning of how that works. So it's not always this way. But for this project, we chose this way to work. Yes?
Oh, I've got one. Ah!
I just needed to
she so wanted to run, and he stopped her.
I did. I'm Carol from California. When I hear the title Letter to the World, I immediately go, okay, dear world, what am I telling you? And from watching the video and stuff, especially on a black screen and all that stuff, it's like, dear world, we are so sad. We are so isolated. We are so this. And so not being a... integral to your project or even seeing it physically, you know, we're have this distance. So what I want to know is when you created that title, Letter to the World, what were you saying? Dear world, what?
Well, you picked the titles.
Yeah. Dear world, I'm sad, I'm fearful, I wish I wasn't saying that, but at that time, but there was also like, hope in wanting to make a shift and wanting to make a change in that. And of course, Letter to the World is a title that has been used by Emily Dickinson, it's been used by Martha Graham, you know, and I know that knowingly and nod to both of them and others. But it's complicated, it's not just one thing. And especially over 12 years, some of it was. But at the time, I think the first one was a little bit, dear world, I'm afraid. But that's not the same for every single one.
Thank you. How have you brought co-creating into other teams that you've worked on?
I've brought it in different manner, not in the same, it's different with each situation because the nature of the project, but I can give an example of, I co-created a book with people who were incarcerated and which we would have dialogue. And of course there's a very different, like a very complex relationship that can be developed in that specific example. But I used co-created and it was very important that everyone who participated, who was in the project, be included. That we were doing this work together. Although our conversation, the conversation I had with Chase and Markéta was very different, but I brought that, and this happened after we did that. I brought that idea of co-creating in many other projects. In just every project is different. Yeah.
I think I brought it into, for instance, co-curating when I was working on the last 36Q. And that was also kind of co-created, very large project. But the safety of what we have here definitely wasn't there because we didn't know each other all that well. It was, and also the size of the project was much bigger because there were 7 artists from different parts of the world and 90 participants. So it's kind of harder to have that kind of luxury. But in terms of the model of letting go of the ego, I really have a huge respect for that because there is that balance and it's really difficult. On one hand, there's exactly what Chase said. We are pushed to produce under an individual name and that is our identity out there trying to find another job, for instance. You send your resume, you send your, and then you have to claim. And claiming something is just hard for me because I'm looking at these pictures of scenography. So we like, how do you claim a chunk of something in order to give it? It's a really conflicting thing. And even just working on this ginormous project, there were so many people who worked on it. It's like going into thousands in different countries. Like, how could you possibly claim any, you know? So that claiming and that showing to the world, this is me. How do you do that? Like, where did that idea even come from? You know, did it really come from your head or did it come from somewhere else, from other people? So I personally have an issue with that constant bordering off, constant labeling off. And this might be different. Like, many theorists love the labels. They love things because they need to be described. I have a problem with it. So I'm just, you know. Any more questions?
I have a question. Thank you for sharing the project, so beautiful. And I also appreciate the reminder how academia sometimes pushes us to have the single authorships and it goes against, you know, it's in for me in writing too or editing, all of it is collaborative, always more fun when things are collaborative, yet we're being pushed against that. I am wondering what is your relationship, or I'm thinking about the performers that we saw in the videos. Are they part of the co-creation? What's the relationship with them?
Of the performances?
The performers, mm-hmm. The dancers, the movers, yeah.
Yep. But like I said, like for Letter to the World 1, when we were rehearsing on stage and creating the dances, Evelyn wasn't up there going 5, 6, 7, 8, you know what I mean? There are times when, you know, yes, I have more choreographic knowledge. But by the time we get to Letter to the World 3, we're making choices together about that because we have a similar language of how movement works within the work. Also, sometimes choreographically, like I might be too close to things and I need, and Markéta will go like, well, wait a minute, what if the dancers do X, Y, or Z? And it's a great thing. So it's not like, I am the choreographer, you shall not talk, you know, about that. And also as dancers, I don't know how many of you are dancers, but many dancers, when you're creating your work in the beginning of your career, you don't have money for sonographers and videographers and things like that. You often are making your own costumes and creating your own sets or whatever. So it's just a way of continuing to learn without the expectation that you're an expert at it or that you're going to call yourself that. So I just feel like it's a way that we can learn as artists. And as an artist, I love working on this project, one, because I love the content of the work, I've been enjoying the results, but also I love learning. I love learning in the process. And so not only did we learn, but we had different casts for Letter to the World 3 because we couldn't take 6 American dancers, so we used an English dancer and whatever, you know. So we've learned a lot from the other people that have been involved in this project as well.
And we did kind of bond with them for longer term, some of them. I mean, some of them stayed from the 1 to 2 to further. Some of them changed. And particularly solving the clothing costume part of it, that was also a lot of conversations about that, like how, because white clothing, costuming on stage, movement, you know, lots of issues. And I remember that we were talking to specific people about how they feel about things. We also sometimes ran into stores with Chase and over a distance, no Zoom.
Yeah, I was literally in New York trying on all these things in the dressing room with Mankin. Does this look good? How's this look? You know, and that's how we picked the costume, because she couldn't get from Alfred, which was the place we were at, to New York City that particular weekend.
And also consulting things with people who are in the piece, and then traveling with some of them, but picking them also in the locations where we traveled to. But those were people we had relationship with that was longer. Like when we went to World Stage Design, we had a person we knew from before. So I think, do we work with these people? Are they part of it? Absolutely, they are part of our process, every single one of them.
And bringing Evelyn into the world of theater and performing arts has been awesome to watch. It's been great. She's like, wow.
Drama.
It's drama.
It's like looking into a mirror that shows you how dramatic our world can be sometimes.
Thank you so much for the answers. We're perfectly on time, so it's time to wrap up. Thank you again to Markéta, to Chase, to Evelyn for sharing their wonderful project and collaboration. Thank you to our audiences.
Thank you.
Thank you.